everyone. This is Bob Souza speaking from historic Main Street in Somerset Village. TV9 is proud to present today the life and times of the late great Roy Campanella. Born in Philadelphia in 1921, passed away in Los Angeles, California in 1993 at the age of 72. 36 years he was involved in professional baseball. 36 years he was a quadriplegic following his accident in 1958, January 28th. So today we will trace the lineage of Roy Campanella, starting out age 15 and 16 in the Negro Leagues with the Baltimore Elite Giants. Then in the Major Leagues, 10 years with the Brooklyn Dodgers, 1948 to 1957. I was very fortunate to see him in his first year playing in the Dodger organization. He was playing for the Nashua Dodgers of the Class B New England League. It was one of very, very few places, actually one of only two places, that integration could take place with the Brooklyn Dodgers of President Brancher, Ricky. He signed Jackie Robinson to play in Montreal and integrate the International League in 46, then to Brooklyn in 47, whereas Campanella spent 46 in Nashua, the New England League. Then in 47, he went to Montreal to become the second black to play there. In 48, for 3 months, he played for the St. Paul Saints of the American Association before he was called up by Leo DeRocha to be with the parent club, Brooklyn Dodgers. He played a month for DeRocha, and then DeRocha was sent packing by Branch Rickey over to the New York Giants, the hated rival of the Brooklyn Dodgers. So DeRocha ends up managing the Giants. Bert Schotten is brought back to manage the Dodgers. He had been the Brooklyn manager in 47 when DeRocha was suspended for hanging out with gamblers, known gamblers, suspended for the entire 47 season by Commissioner Happy Chandler. Also at Nashua in the New England League, I got to see three visits of Roy Campanella playing against the Fall River Indians. The last place team in the New England League was an independent team owned by Joe Madowski, who was a landlord many times over with the tenement homes in Fall River. He could not finance the team as an independent team. Chicago White Sox sent a few players to him their last year, 1949. Some of the other Dodger people who got their start in Nashua, 1946, general manager Emil Buzzy Bavese, who later went to Brooklyn, from Brooklyn out to Los Angeles. When the Dodgers moved there, he ended up also at San Diego. Walter Alston was a player manager for the Dodgers at Nashua, first baseman, only had 17 players on a roster. He then moved to St. Paul, and then in 1954 up to Brooklyn. And of course, he won the World Series against the Yankees in 55. Also, World Series winner when they moved to Los Angeles in 59, when they beat the White Sox in 6 games. And World Series winner 1963, 1965. He signed 23 one-year contracts with the Dodger organization because that's all they granted. Both owners, Branch Rickey and later Walter O'Malley insisted one-year contracts only for their personnel. Also for Nashua, visiting Fall River in 46, Don Newcomb, 6'4", 220 pounds, fireballing right-hander, had to spend another year in Nashua, 1947, and the last of the black players to come to Fall River with Nashua, 1948, pitcher Dan Bankhead. So sit back and relax, get a look at Roy Campanella moving through the Brooklyn organization with the Dodgers, 1948 to 1957. Played on 8 All-Star teams, 5 World Series, 3 times Most Valuable Player, 1951, 1953, 1955. Terrible accident in his Chevrolet rental automobile, January of 1958, ice patches in the road, hit a telephone pole and was paralyzed from the neck down. Tragically, that ended his baseball career.
Dodger All-Star Roy Campanella stands in at the plate. Giants pitcher Sal Magley gets the sign, delivers. Campanella smashes a tremendous drive into the left field stands. Roy Campanella, one of the greatest catchers ever to play the game, has hit a home run.
In the late 30s, the seed of a baseball legend begins to unfold in Philadelphia. Roy Campanella establishes himself as a player of major league caliber while catching in America's Negro Leagues. Becomes the second black player signed by Branch Rickey of the Brooklyn Dodgers. Helps lead the Brooklyn Dodgers to 4 National League pennants and to their first World Championship ever. Former Green Bay great Paul Hornung met with Campanella at Hornung's Atlantic City, New Jersey penthouse suite, where they explored the legend of one of the greatest catchers in baseball history.
During the 30s and the 40s, across the sandlots of America, there grew a fascination for the game of baseball. This fascination blew a breath of life into the dreams of some of America's small-town young men that found form in one of the greatest and most exciting baseball teams ever to step on the diamond. Their story is one of prejudice and courage, tragedy and triumph, of America and its struggle to come to grips with a changing world. Instrumental in altering the public's opinion was Roy Campanella, who became the second black player to sign a major league contract. After 12 years with the Negro Leagues, Campy went on to establish himself as one of the greatest catchers ever to play in the major leagues. During this critical period of baseball growth, Roy Campanella, along with the other boys of the summer, ushered in the beginning of a new era.
There's the boys of summer. Of course, Roger Kahn wrote one of the great sports books of all time.
Those fellas consist of Gil Hodges at first base, Jackie Robinson at second, Pee Wee Reese at short, Billy Cox at third, and in outfield was Ferrello, Duke Snider, and Gene Hermansky, and Sandy Amorose, and the fans outside of Ebbets Field. I doubt if there's any ballpark today or stadium that had the enthusiasm of the old Dodger fans.
You know, of course, Jackie Robinson broke the color line coming into baseball, but Roy, you signed, what, at 15 years old? You played 12 years in the Negro Leagues before you got a chance to come.
Yes, I go way back to 1937. I signed with the Baltimore Eli Giants in the old Negro National League at 15, but I would go to school on weekdays and play on weekends.
And from after 12 years of making $3,000 a season, this is your manager, Buzzy Bavasi. I think this might be a little bit more than $3,000.
Well, yes, I'd say so at that meeting then. But I never realized, Paul, that it was as big paying money as I thought it was. I just wanted the opportunity to play in the major leagues. Is Jack?
It's Japanese American Day at Ebbets Field.
Yes, getting a beautiful lady.
Joe Hodges.
Yes, quite a guy.
He was a catcher, wasn't he?
Yes, when I reported to the Dodgers, Gil Hodges was a catcher. And our manager at that time was Leo DeRocher. And he gave Hodges a first baseman's mitt and told him to go down and work out at first base, that I was going to be on the catching staff then. Hodges developed into the best first baseman in the National League, in my opinion. Number 39.
Loved to throw, didn't you?
Love.
You were throwing out base runners at, well, almost 75%, which was a far cry for the average in those days.
You know, Paul, but in spring training, I would always stay out a little later and just practice throwing for a half an hour or so.
Look at this one. This is a series.
Yes, Walter Alston.
No, I think this is the All-Star game.
Yes.
Right, and I guess that was always a big thrill for you to be able to catch it.
Oh.
Set a record, caught 55 consecutive innings.
Yes.
In All-Star.
Yes, I did.
Look at these guys. Williams, Krzyzewski. Look at the arms.
Stan Musial.
I'd like to ask you, at the beginning when you came up, Roy, Jackie Robinson, of course, say was very quiet for the first couple of years. You got there, and how was the relationship with you and Jackie playing in the big leagues?
Well, number one, first, when I joined the Dodgers, Jackie and I were roommates. Mm-hmm. And the harassing kind of cut down quite a bit. Sure, you would hear some catcalls from the stands and from some of our opposition. But these things wore off.
Get the earplugs in.
Oh. Well, I think any good athlete, if you listen to the stands, you're not going to do too well out there on the field. You have to keep your mind on what you're doing.
Robinson was some kind of athlete.
Oh, tremendous athlete. But Jackie would, he got to the point that he started fighting back. And, I mean, Mr. Rickey used to tell us, it meant more to the team for you to stay in the game. And when you started arguing and with the umpire and opposition players and get put out of ball games, you would hurt our own ball club, which we knew. And sometimes you turn your head and bite your tongue and just accept a lot and say, well, I'm going to stay in the ball game, forget all this.
Well, Roy, you had some great series, crosstown rivalries in the New York Giants. what games that the Dodgers and the Giants had in those years, we're going to be right back in a minute with some of that.
Very good.
Dodger-Giants series. What a rivalry.
The subway. And that was quite something. From Brooklyn to New York, New York back to Brooklyn. And playing the Giants, regardless whatever position the Giants were in or the Dodgers, it was always a top series.
Not too many people realize that while you were playing winter ball in Venezuela, managing down there, the three guys that you nominated are told the Dodger organization about as a scout, I guess, reacting as a scout when you recommended this young man, Willie Mays.
Willie Mays, Monty Irvin.
Larry Doby.
I recommended to the Dodgers also Doby. The Dodgers did have Monty Irvin to an extent on paper, and then there was some kind of confusion and they had to let him go, and he went to the Giants. That's Yankee Stadium there. Tommy Byrne pitching. The Yankee was a little tough. You know, I played in 5 World Series, and we were lucky enough to beat the Yankees one of them.
Lucky enough.
That's right. I'd say lucky enough in those days. What a team the Yankees had.
The scene now shifts to Yankee Stadium for the 6th game of this exciting 1953 World Series. In the first inning, the Yankees start to apply pressure as Yogi Berra, with 2 men on, slams a double to right field to score the first run of the game. Later in the inning, the Yanks load the bases against the struggling Erskine. Then Billy Martin. He drives a hot ground to the second baseman, Junior Gilliam, who can't get a handle on the ball as the Yanks score another run to take a 2-0 lead at the end of the first inning. The Yanks come to the bat in the second inning after the Dodgers fail the tally. And Phil Rizzuto drives the ball into center field for a single. Pitcher Whitey Ford, after faking a bunt, hits a single, and Rizzuto is able to move all the way to third. Gene Woodling, the next Yank batter, lofts a fly ball to shallow left field, which Jackie Robinson gloves, but it's deep enough to bring Rizzuto home on the sacrifice fly, and the Yankees take a 3-0 lead over the desperate Dodgers. After Joe Collins singles, Hank Bauer walks to load the bases. The next play almost defies description in World Series play. Yogi Berra at the plate hits a towering drive to right field. Snyder brings it in near the 407-foot mark. At third base, Whitey Ford forgets to tag the bag, becomes confused, and is thrown out of the plate in the relay from Jim Gilliam. After two innings, the Yankees have a 3-0 lead. In the sixth inning with one gone, the Dodgers' Jackie Robinson smashes a long drive into left field, and Robinson goes into second, standing up. With Campanella at the plate, Robinson steals third. Campanella hits a slow grounder to second baseman Billy Martin, and Jackie Robinson is able to score from third to give the Dodgers their first run. After six innings, the Yankees still have a commanding 3-1 lead. In the top half of the ninth inning, the Dodgers face Yank reliever Ally Chief Reynolds. As Duke Snyder walks, the Dodgers bring the game-tying runner to the plate. Paul Firillo standing at home plate. Blasts a tremendous drive, 8 rows into the right field grandstand. And the Dodgers tie up the Yanks in this dramatic sixth World Series game. In the last half of the ninth inning, Mickey Mantle hits a slow bounder down to third baseman Billy Cox. Mantle legs it out for a single, and the Yanks have men at first and second. Labine now faces Billy Martin, who lashes out a drive to center field and drives in Hank Bauer to end this exciting 1953 World Series and give the New York Yankees and manager Casey Stengel an unprecedented fifth consecutive World Series championship.
This is the 55 World Series.
Yes.
You get down 2-0 in the first two games. The Yanks win the first two, then you homer in the third and the fourth games to tie it up.
Yankee Stadium, the exciting seventh and final game of the 1955 World Series, will be played to its dramatic conclusion. As the teams enter the top of the fourth, the score is still knotted, nothing to nothing. In the Dodger fourth, Roy Campanella comes to plate facing Tommy Byrne. He smashes a line drive down the third baseline that Yankee left fielder Elston Howard has trouble tracking down. Campanella comes into second base standing up. Next up is Carl Farrillo. He grounds out to Rizzuto as Campanella moves over to third. As Tommy Byrne studies the situation, Gil Hodges comes to the dish. Byrne fires the ball. Hodges lines a drive into the outfield, enabling Campanella to score from third. And Brooklyn jumps into a 1-0 lead in the fourth. In the sixth inning, Pee Wee Reese faces Tommy Byrne and drives the ball into left center field for a single as Brooklyn mounts another charge. Duke Snyder attempts a bunt down the third base line. Byrne comes up with the ball and pegs the first baseman Moose Scourin, who drops the ball. The Dodgers now have men on first and second. Tommy walks the next man to load the bases, and manager Casey Stengel makes his appearance to the mound. Stengel makes his decision and calls in Bob Grimm to put out the fire. With only one away and the bases loaded, Gil Hodges smashes a long drive to center field. Bob serve makes the catch, but Reese scores from third on the sacrifice fly, and the Dodgers take a 2-0 lead. In the sixth, Billy Martin draws a walk. Johnny Padre sets his grip for a curve and lets it go. McDougal lays down a beautiful bunt and legs it out for a single as Martin moves up to second. Yogi Berra comes to bat and hits the ball down the left field line. After a long run, Sandy Amoros makes a tremendous catch, relays the ball to Pee Wee Reese, and doubles up McDougal off first base. Moving into the bottom of the ninth, with one gone now, Big Bob Serve hits a high fly into left field, and Sandy Amoros puts it away for the second Yankee out. Only one out remaining, the Yanks' last hope rests on Elston Howard. Padres delivers a changeup. The strategy works as Howard grounds to Reese, who flips the ball over to Hodges for the final out. The game ends with Padres pitching superb baseball and in leading the Brooklyn Dodgers over the New York Yankees for the first time ever in World Series play. Pandemonium fills the stands and the field.
See, the people in Brooklyn went wild that night, that we won the fourth and final game as we went wild out there. But when you see things like this, that's the little boy coming out in you then.
It's amazing. Sometimes the great ones like you have it all your life. We've got some of the film of the last days of Ebbets Field, when Walter O'Malley started thinking about moving the Dodgers to the West Coast. We'll have that in just a moment. Must feel pretty good coming to spring practice the following year after having been world champions.
Yes, returning to your spring training base and being world champions is nothing like it, Paul.
In 1956, you win the pennant again, but running into the old nemesis again, the
yes.
World Series.
It was tough to beat the Yankees in those days.
Here at Yankee Stadium, fifth game, 1956 World Series. Don Larson, going into the top of the ninth inning, has pitched a perfect ball. With one away, Roy Campanella grounds the ball to second base, and that brings up number eight, Dale Mitchell, as Brooklyn's last hope. Off the stretch, the first pitch is strike one. Swing and a miss for strike two. Larson is a picture of concentration now. Can he do it? Rubs it up. The pitch. Mitchell calls strike three. A perfect game for Don Larson as his teammates mob him. He becomes the first pitcher ever to pitch a perfect game in World Series play.
Everybody says, what a game this guy pitched. Of course, it's a perfect game in the World Series. You said it's the greatest game that you've ever seen a pitcher throw.
Yes, and I was on the losing end of that game. I had never played in any, and I'd never seen any. But Larson pitched a tremendous game that day, and what I can remember about that day so good, Snyder hit two balls in the right field stand, but they were foul.
Last game at Ebbets Field.
Yes. You know, that was my last season, too.
57.
That's right. I didn't know it was going to be my last season, but it was. Mm-hmm. I thought I'd be able to go to Los Angeles with the rest of the team, but in between I had the automobile accident. Yes,
this is your liquor store. You still have this?
Yes, I opened that up in 1951. And thank goodness I still have it. And I go to a lot of schools also now.
This is one of the injuries you had.
Yes, Reynolds hit me with the pitch in the World Series. And I had to have two operations on my hand. See, this brings back old memories. That's 134th Street and 7th Avenue, where my store is located. Yeah, that's going back a few years. Ebbets Field Apartments again is going up there at Old Ebbets Field.
Yeah, this is the big ceremony at Ebbets Field when they were starting to rip it down. And I think quite appropriately, they dug up home plate and gave it to you.
Yes, sitting out there that day and they dug up home plate and give it to me. And to see that wrecking ball on that crane and to build up on a big apartment there and called it Jackie Robinson Apartments was really fitting.
It was in January of 58 you had the accident.
Yes.
You've been a great inspiration for so many people, Roy, and your attitude after the accident.
Well, Paul, I felt after my accident, I had accepted my wheelchair and being able to get around from city to city and travel as much as I did and be shown in my wheelchair, it encouraged so many other people in institutions that were paralyzed that wouldn't get out.
And this day you'll never forget. The largest crowd ever to see a baseball game, and that's still a record, Roy Campanella night in Los Angeles.
Yes, there was 93,000 people there. Pee-wee was pushing me out there, our dandy captain, as I always called him, number one. There's Casey Stengel and Walter Alston again. And believe it or not, we were playing the Yankees again that night. No, I wasn't able to play because I was in that wheelchair. But I'll never forget that night, Paul. That is the greatest tribute ever paid to anyone, I'd say.
Roy had a fantastic career. 12 years with the Negro Leagues, 10 years with the Brooklyn Dodgers, three of which you were voted most valuable player in the National League. And then the big moment when you were inducted into Cooperstown, the Hall of Fame with your old friend, Stan Musial.
Thank you, Commissioner. It's more than an honor for me to be here. I had no idea as a teenager that this was in the future of my life. It's so fitting for me to sit up here with a Stan Musial. Regardless being in this wheelchair, I consider today as one of the greatest moments in my life. I'm very proud to have been a part of baseball on any level because I loved it. Words could not express everything that I'd like to say, but today means so much to me. Thank you, and may my fellow members accept me for what I have done.
Roy Campanella, a black pioneer in the major leagues, whose talents earned him enshrinement in baseball's Hall of Fame. When Roy Campanella's baseball career ended after the 1957 season, he had won 3 National League Most Valuable Player awards, having established himself as one of the hardest hitting, most accurate throwing catchers in Major League history. Today, Roy Campanella is a successful New York City businessman. He lives there with his wife and children. Long live Roy Campanella, and long live his legend.
Our program closes today with a tribute to the home of the Brooklyn Dodgers, Ebbets Field, which opened in 1913 and closed in 1957. 45 years of Major League Baseball was played there. One World Championship, Johnny Padre's great pitching over the Yankees in 1955. In today's show, the conclusion is based upon a musical tribute to Ebbets Field written by a Fall River musical composer named Joe Raposa. Durfee grad, Joe wrote the music to Sesame Street and also to the Muppets. He went to New York, was very, very highly regarded, and made some great friends in New York. Barbara Streisand, the great female vocalist who was born and raised in Brooklyn, was offered the opportunity to sing Joey's song, "There Used to Be a Ballpark Here." She and her agent took a pass on it, figuring it was not of any interest in 1973, since the Dodgers had gone from Ebbets Field in 58, the first year in the Los Angeles area. So then he called in another friend, Joe's personal friend from Hoboken, New Jersey, Old Blue Eyes, Frank Sinatra, sang, "There Used to Be a Ballpark Here." And in 73, he sold 1 million copies of that song. The actual destruction with the Wreckers ball was 1960, February of 60. Some of the old-time Dodgers were there, including Roy Campanella, Carl Erskine, Ralph Branca, as they bid adieu to Ebbets Field. The wrecking ball was painted white and had red stripes on it to indicate the baseball. Tragically, that was the end of one of the greatest ballparks ever. We ask that, or we thank the audience for being with us today. We know you're going to enjoy the tribute to Roy Campanella and his beloved Brooklyn Dodgers and their iconic home at Ebbets Field. Thanks for watching, folks. We'll be rounding third and heading home. Thank you.
there used to be a ballpark where the field was warm and green, and the people played their crazy game with a joy I'd never seen. And the air was such a wonder, from the hot dogs and the beer. Yes, there used to be a ballpark right here. And there used to be rock candy and a great big 4th of July, with the fireworks exploding all across the summer sky. And the people watched in wonder how they laugh and how they cheer. And there used to be a ballpark right here. Now the children try to find it, and they can't believe their eyes, 'cause the old team just isn't playing, and the new team hardly tries. And the sky has got so cloudy, when it used to be so clear. And the summer went so quickly this year. Yes, there used to be a ballpark right